Muito boa tarde a todos. Bem-vindos à quinta conferência deste terceiro ciclo de conferências da Fulbright Alumni Association. Fico muito contente de os ver a todos de novo. Quero dar uma pequena explicação. Houve uma alteração no programa, porque o nosso colega vice-presidente da direção queria fazer hoje a manutenção da conferência, por motivos inesperados, não o pôde fazer e pedimos à nossa colega vogal da direção também, professora Teresa Alves, que nos desse a honra e o prazer de nos acompanhar e de fazer ela a manutenção. E muito gentilmente, mesmo sobre a hora, acedeu a ajudar-nos e por isso queremos agradecer. Em nome da Comissão Fulbright e em nome da direção. E, sem mais delongas, dou a palavra à professora Teresa Alves. Teresa, se quiser fazer a apresentação.
Faço a apresentação, pronto.
Sim.
Eu estou-me a ouvir, não estão?
Estamos, sim.
Ótimo.
Tudo bem.
It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Miguel Muniz, who is a researcher at the Center for Research in Anthropology, a joint venture of ISCTE, Universidade Nova, Universidade de Coimbra e Universidade do Minho. Professor Muniz examines migration from Portugal to North America, association and associativism, racialization process of migrants, including the racialization of labor, the labor movement, and social and political activism. Muniz returned to Brown University, where he received a PhD in anthropology as the Flagg Brown Visiting Professor in 2019. And he remained at Brown for the academic year of 2020-21 as a visiting scholar. He's also the director of the Migrant Communities Project, a nonprofit organization that develops community-based humanities, cultural and social issues, educational programs. His most recent publication is The Day of Portugal and Portuguese Heritage, Social Exclusion and Imagined Mobilities, Legacies of Racialized Migrant Industrial Labor in Contemporary New England. He was also a Fulbright Scholar in the Azores in 1998-1999. So now his talk today is titled Creating Black and White Portuguese in the United States, Some Notes on Racial Inequalities and the Fight for Multicultural Democracy, a most intriguing subject. Let's listen to Professor Muniz.
Não conseguimos ouvi-lo, professor.
There it is. Yeah. So thank you again to Professor Teresa Alves and Professor Laura, also to Fulbright Commission for their invitation to speak at this fantastic series. With the exception of one that I wasn't able to attend for conflicts that were unavoidable, I've attended all of the other talks, and really just a really great slate and a fascinating slate. So. So thank you to Dr. Lauda for putting this whole program together. Really informative, informative and interesting group of talks. I hope that I can come close to what my colleagues have done with their great stuff that they've talked about. I'm going to share the screen, if that's okay with you all. And let's see. So I need to do this. So this talk is actually, I'll put in the chat later on, I will put a small link to the paper that I, that a lot of this is based on, this talk is, or some of this talk is based on, for you all to take a look at. It actually just came out online. So I'm excited for, if anybody wants to take a deeper dive into some of these topics, I would send you to that paper. So what I'd really like to talk about here is, first off is, whoops. Hold on a sec. Whoops, I'm losing my screen. There we go. Whoops, comments. There we go. So I guess I'll look at it this way so I can see some other stuff I need here. So basically this talk is, I'm gonna do, trying to do, accomplish a couple of things with this talk. One is to try and just provide a broad background of this category of so-called white and black Portuguese. In that, sort of just a little primer on some of the topics and some of the issues. Everybody can see my slide presentation. Yeah, just as a, okay, good. So, you know, to try and understand some of these bigger themes and to, you know, to really, really delve into how we understand how these categories work today, we really need to try to get a sort of a background on some of these, on how these categories emerged, you know, in the context of the US. It's really important also to mention or to note that some of my assumptions in discussing all this with you is that I come from a point of view, as do most anthropologists, historians, social scientists, of, you know, what we call social constructed identities. And what we mean by that effectively is that, you know, these identities are fluid, they're not fixed identities. The meaning of black and white changes over time. The meaning of black and white changes on geographic context. The meaning of black and white changes on political context as well. So I had the pleasure, the great pleasure of being part of a really fascinating project, ERC Advanced Grant Project at University of Lisbon, ECS, called The Color of Labor. I was a fellow in the project, and you know, my colleagues, as well as you know, as well as my own opportunities to do some great research into how labor practices actually shape racial identities. I specifically looked at New England, and mostly focused on the 20th century. But I actually like to go back a little bit farther than that, just to give you some background. So. We really, when we talk about how these categories of Portuguese racial identities emerged, we really, I think, have to go back. I mean, we can really honestly go back, I think, to the early modern period and arguments over, you know, the black legend of the Spanish and Portuguese that take place. I don't want to go back that far, obviously. And I'm also not an early modern scholar. But in any case, we'll start mid 19th century in the U.S., and ethnologists, 19th century ethnologists, arguments, you know, over what it meant, why was slavery justified? And the arguments that took place effectively were arguments that, again, were, you know, several hundred years old, that naturalized the labor and the bodies of, the abuse of the bodies of certain individuals, and tried to make arguments about their mental, physical, psychological inferiority. Or what some in the early modern period called a disposition towards natural slavery. And what that meant was they had particular mentalities that made them, that made certain groups of people, you know, not disposed or made them disposed to difficult work or to serving others. This, of course, is incredibly self-serving arguments, right? It was people that were making this decision, putting their laborers at the point of a gun and threatening them with violence, threatening them with death if they didn't work. So it really didn't have to do with natural characteristics. It had to do with it had to do with the creation of an ideology of difference in order to allow a particular group of people to structure their control over the labor system. I recently saw my niece has been trying to get me to see the musical Hamilton, which I don't know if any of you have seen, but it's really fantastic. I finally got around to seeing it. And one of the lines in it talks about how the Southern states had a fantastic economy and labor system. And the remark is, well, of course you do. You don't have to pay for labor. So this is at the heart, really, of how racial identities get structured and built into slavery, built into the labor force. Portuguese start entering into this pretty early. So this is from 1855. I don't know if anybody has heard of Melville's, it's not a book, it's an article that appeared in Harper's Monthly in 1855 called Melville and the Guise, called the Guise. And the Guise were basically a derivation of the Portuguese. He creates kind of a gloss of this category that encompasses all kinds of different Portuguese identities, the way he describes it. Some people have written about this as a very racist text by Melville. I'm not a Melville scholar, but the Melville scholars that I've talked to, and the fact that I also read a lot of Melville just for my own enjoyment and for my own interests. But I think that Karcher's analysis in 1975 that analyzes Melville's Guise as a satire on the ethnologists of the period is actually a pretty compelling and interesting argument. But nonetheless, what Melville does is he establishes a couple of key concepts here. And one is this notion of Portuguese identities being somehow in the US being not quite white or suspect white, as some scholars have called it, their white identities were both questioned, but also malleable enough that they could be not white in some contexts and be considered to be white in certain other contexts. This had an incredible importance, especially in the latter part of the 1800s. Ariella Gross does some incredible research on court cases in the US South, and effectively goes through them and looks at how individuals who were considered to be non-white because they weren't able to own property, they weren't able to vote, they weren't able to sue in court, have standing in court. Remember, you have no citizenship rights if you're not white in the United States at this point. And really, even until 1952, if you're an immigrant to the US that's considered, that comes from Africa, you're not allowed to become a US citizen. This has some important implications for people from Cape Verde and for some other Portuguese islands in the 20th century. But in any event, what Gross finds is that this notion of Portugueseness or this Portuguese category becomes a category that's quite fluid, that individuals make an argument. And in one point in a court case, the lawyer effectively says, I never said that my client was white. I said that they were Portuguese, therefore they're not black. So this category of Portuguese maintained a very interstitial and liminal category between blackness and whiteness at certain points. And again, one of the whole arguments of my talk here today is not to say that that there's any particular definition of whiteness or blackness, that all of these definitions of whiteness or blackness are really contested power relations social mobility has as a component being able to have a malleable racial mobility, given the fact that white supremacism and white nationalism dominated US politics over the 20th century. So moving on. You also have other, so I'm gonna talk about a couple of different areas where these categories emerged. One was a prominent way that this emerged was with early 20th century sociologists. So most people are familiar with Donald Taft. Donald Taft gets most of the press. People have been writing about him for many years. There's a couple of more recent, really interesting articles about him also, looking at the responses to Taft in New England. But effectively Taft, Donald Taft writes a 1923 Columbia dissertation, and he makes a hypothesis, or he hypothesizes that Portuguese were somehow had higher rates of, or certain Portuguese had higher rates of infant mortality, and a whole range of other social problems related to poverty. And he hypothesizes that perhaps it had to do with a higher percentage of Negroid blood among certain groups of Portuguese. Mainly the group that he was looking at was in Fall River, and talking about people from São Miguel. But in any case, these were very common. This was a very common sociological tool. If you look at this, I took this here from Folkmar's collected his taxonomies and dictionary that appeared with the Dillingham Commission reports. But I don't know if you're reading along. I'm not going to really make much remarks on my slides. I'll feel free to read them as I go along and talk about other things. But the idea is that Folkmar essentially presents, he continues with these ethnologist arguments about what the races, he has taxonomies of races and where the Portuguese fit and where they didn't fit. This is in his definition of Negro immigrants, where he talks about, he mentions both the Azores and Cape Verde. And again, all the sociologists take very, very different tracks on many of these, with many of these, with their definitions of where Portuguese fit. So I'll pull up a bunch here that I don't think many people have talked about. In this article that just came, recently came out, I talk a bit about Frederick Bushy and Edward Ross, who were both mostly writing about Boston, 1903 and 1914. And in these works, they were essentially trying to figure out what was the composition of all of these new industrial migrants. So one of the things that's, one of the great mythologies of Portuguese migration to the US is that everybody came on a whaling boat. You know, if you go to some of the museums in this area, I'm in New England right now, but if you go to some of the museums in this area, what you see sometimes are, you know, celebrations of seaboat captains without a lot of, you know, the Portuguese that became a seaboat captain or the Cape Verdeans that became seaboat captains. And that's actually a brilliant story to tell, an important story to tell, actually, the fact that this happened. But it's important to realize the context in which they were able to become a seaboat captain. And not to think of that as the only story and ignore the fact that most of the people that were coming from Portugal or coming from the Azores and Cabo Verde working on these whaling boats were actually, were not workers that were running ships. They were hired hands that lived very difficult and arduous lives on the ships. So another thing that people think is the percentages. I always like to ask this question, and people almost always invariably get it wrong. I won't do it here because we're Zooming, but if you were to break down the amount of migrants that came from like 1830 to 1930 and put sort of a dividing line in the middle of it at around 1870 when the industrial labor, second industrial revolution takes place, and you have a great amount of migrant labor coming to New England from the Azores, Cape Verde, and also continental Portugal. The percentages of what you think would come before 1870 and after 1870 is shocking to everyone, but it's more than 90% came from 1870 to 1830 than came before that time period. So when we talk about whaling boats, what we're really doing is romanticizing, I think, in some ways, an immigrant origin story that doesn't match up with the reality of most of these immigrants coming in a very difficult time to work in very difficult jobs as in the lowest tiers of as industrial laborers. And the Portuguese weren't the only ones that were coming. And when I say Portuguese, of course, I mean Cape Verdeans, Azoreans, continental Portuguese, Madeirenses, people from other islands, etc., which is mostly where the mobile labor circulation was coming from these places to New England, also Hawaii, California, and other destinations in the Caribbean. Focusing on New England again, we have these interesting writers here. W. Jett Locke is another sociologist who's responsible for most of the work on the Portuguese that's written up in the Dillingham Commission reports. Dillingham Commission reports was a governmental document that got published from around 1911. And they were effectively was a 41 volume set of studies taking place by sociologists and also some political figures, as well as a volume that was written by that just basically took statements by interested parties, mostly people in labor unions and other immigrants associations in America at the time. And these volumes effectively try to solve, in quotes, the immigrant problem, what they consider to be the immigrant problem. And you know, they saw these migrants, so they cast these migrants in similar terms as the ethnologists did, in that the reasons for their servitude, the reasons why they should not be given citizenship and civic participation rights, was because they were mentally, morally inferior. And if you've taken the time to read this little quote, you can sort of see how some of this writing characterizes the Portuguese, talking about them in terms of morals. Also in this quotation, it's very interesting. They don't call the Portuguese black, but they make them black adjacent in the text, if you look at this. So there's already these hierarchies being created of racialized laborer hierarchies that are being created that cast these Portuguese immigrants as non-white. So this is a very interesting phenomenon, especially because in Portugal, definitions of racial identity in Portugal operate in, you know, in very different ways than they did when these migrants landed in New England and became inserted into these labor hierarchies in the industrial mills. And then also in agricultural labor, which they also started to do, many of them left industrial labor positions and moved out to rural areas like Cape Cod, where they were farmers. Most people think of Cape Cod and Portuguese fishermen, but really most of the Portuguese that were not working industrial mills were working in places like Dartmouth, North Dartmouth, along the coast in Little Compton, and also on Cape Cod as agricultural labor. And most of them were working for, I don't have a slide here, I usually do, but most of them were working in places like cranberry bogs. The cranberry bog owners in Harwich, for example, and on the Cape, there were arguments that especially in Harwich, that wanted to place Cape Verdeans and other Portuguese into segregated schools in Harwich. There's some polemics also on Cape Cod and Falmouth, where an exchange of letters in the early part of the 1900s, back and forth between one of the owners of the largest cranberry enterprises, wanted to create a segregated school in East Falmouth where most of the people that worked on his bogs were working. This set off a huge, interesting back and forth in the of letters in the local newspaper, in which Portuguese both, on the one hand, you had a response by the bog owner basically saying that the Portuguese were less than human, the language that he uses to describe them. They're lice-ridden, odoriferous, they smell really bad, they have no hygiene, they have no morals. They shouldn't be in school with other children. And he gets seconded by some other people in town. A Portuguese person writes back using language written by an immigrant, and it's not a very clean or polished letter. The individual ends up starting more letters to, you know, making fun of his bad English, which then becomes another way to create this distinction between civilized white owners and the you know, the non-white Portuguese who are illiterate and lacking in morals, etc. Finally, another another letter by one of the Portuguese, he tries to make an argument that some Portuguese are black, yes, but other Portuguese are not. So yes, it's true that some Portuguese are black and they should be in segregated schools, but other Portuguese are not and they should not. This is actually a polemic that takes place by one Portuguese writer. Another Portuguese writer writes back after that and actually says, no, in fact, this is a much broader issue that does not have to do with who's black and who's white, or has to do with, or rather has to, has, doesn't have to do with what Portuguese are black or white. It has to do simply with blackness and whiteness and the way that white nationalism was structuring this debate and was trying to push the Portuguese into segregated schools because, again, they were considered to be all non-white by the bog owner. So Dillingham Commission reports, I have a quick little quote here from Dillingham, but this 41 volumes really lays out a number of these arguments and effectively puts the Portuguese into a non-white racialized category. I'm gonna jump ahead here to a couple of threads after this sociological background. So there's two kind of differences here in unraveling these categories of what it means, what Black and white Portuguese means, and how these categories emerged. So the first is presaged by this exchange of letters that I just talked about, which is discourses and codification that define the Portuguese either as white or Black. Are the Portuguese white or the Portuguese Black? And then another discourse, which is there are Portuguese and they're either white or they're non-white. And what's important to point out is that there are a lot of competing, all kinds of competing definitions taking place. So I'll jump back a slide here. Bushy and Kengott placed the Portuguese in a non-white, and again, all Portuguese, not just Portuguese from certain geographies. Although their writing is cross-cut with fine-toothed analyses of this geography having, much like Taft, having more Negroid blood than this geography. Of course, the concept of Negroid blood is nonsensical, but this is the way that they characterized it. As Locke, Kengott, interesting, George Kengott, who writes about Lowell in 1911, 1912, does not place the Portuguese as a non-white group. Folkmar presents some studies that put them as in a white group and other studies that put them in a non-white group. So the sociologists really, there's no consensus about in their, there's no consensus because it's not a scientific category, right? They were making effectively social arguments about these identities, not scientific arguments about these identities. Even though it was couched in a language of science, there's nothing scientific about it. So the other kind of thread to think about, if you talk about some of these other the rest of the issues and for the remaining part of the talk, is to think also about how the law and the political system have been used to support institution and actions that racialize the labor force and structure inequality. So one of the important things to think about here is the way that political activism also played into this. So one of the ways that the labor, that white supremacism works, or that privilege works, there's lots of ways to think about it. And privileges are overlapping. It's not just white nationalist privilege. There are all kinds of other forms of class-based, gender-based, age-based privilege that takes place. And one of the ways that that white nationalist privilege was structured was by creating a group that was, how can I put it, that was constrained by, that was not constrained by the law, but was protected by it. And then having a labor force that was constrained by the law, but not protected by the law. So what it meant to be a citizen, what it meant to be, to have civic rights as a migrant worker, your civic rights were greatly limited. You could be put in a jail very easily. You could, effectively the protest movement was criminalized. This is a picture of a group of I believe this is the Textile Mill Committee in New Bedford in 1928, the strike of 28, which was a major strike in New England during the industrial labor rights movement. This woman here is the famous Eula Menge that some of you may have heard of, who became an activist and was eventually deported as a result of her Communist Party work. So because the labor unions were not protecting and were not supporting migrants, like you couldn't, if you were a low wage earning industrial labor migrant, you were considered, again, non-white, and you weren't allowed to join craft and skill labor unions. And so the only way that one could organize was through socialist and communist labor party organization. And many Portuguese joined in this movement, even ones who were not directly involved with the Communist Party. If they were working with, if they were working on any sort of labor movement activity, they were being supported by the activities of a Communist Party, a labor organization. This includes the IWW and some other groups that came up, more local groups, more local unions. You know, and you had people like Joe Figueiredo. He ends up in the 1950s, after his work as a labor union organizer and leader, testifying in front of the House Un-American Activities Committee. He was a US citizen, so he was not deported. However, you know, Eula Mensch, and there's others. There's Augusto Pinto, was another strike captain working in the labor movement. And he also, he ends up getting deported back to Portugal and disappears on the way to Tarrafal. So Eula Mensch, when she gets deported in the 50s, as a result of her communist affiliation, I'm kind of jumping around here because Eula Mensch commits the crimes for which she gets deported in the 20s and 30s, and then gets deported in the 1950s in a second wave of anti-labor movement and anti-migrant activities in the US. So all of these categories get collapsed. Labor identities, efforts and attempts to gain civic rights, and you can see by this sort of political cartoon, this collapsing of political identities with migrant identities. And again, it's not just migrant identities, it's racialized migrant labor identities, right? That's playing out here in some of these, in this context. So as a counter against some of this ethnologist thinking that looks at levels of competence and, you know, whether one has the moral background, the sort of naturalized abilities of one to have citizenship status, the progressive Americanization movement in the US takes place beginning in the 19-teens and moving through the 1920s. And Portuguese associations and other Portuguese groups end up taking an active role in the Americanization movement. So the Americanization movement effectively makes an argument that one's status or all of the social problems that are really the result of one's low place in as an exploited labor group isn't about genetic ability. It's really about education and learning how to become a good an American, learning about civics, American civics, leaving behind the old, the old ways. And a lot of the communist labor movement was coming, especially in among the Portuguese, was coming from syndicalists from the north of Portugal. In fact, people from the Azores were not necessarily active leaders in the labor movement because there wasn't a large tradition of labor movement history in the Azores. Most of it was coming from people that had, you know, decades of experience. Eula Mensch, for example, her father was a syndicalist in Gouveia, where she was from, where she was from. So in any case, the idea was to get them to stop thinking about their old country and to Americanize. And there were tremendous pressures on Portuguese, some great recent scholarship by people like Luís Nuno Rodrigues, as well as Gilberto Fernandes, who just published a great book this year that looks at the role of the Estado Novo in trying to keep the Portuguese from Americanizing, also the role of the church in keeping the Portuguese from Americanizing, is really a fascinating reading, and I would encourage anyone to go check that out. But in any case, the process that took place with Americanization really effectively was a white nationalist movement to get the immigrant to capitulate effectively to the rules to the rules that govern institutional white nationalist institutional power controlled by white nationalists. And it's what's interesting about this is that various Black associations in the US also participated in the Americanization movement. You can also see at this point, when we talk about Cabo Verdeans and Portuguese, there's some interesting, in the 1940s, for example, as part of Americanization movement, or 1930s, you have a whole bunch of associations that have what they call Americanization goals. And these are Portuguese American associations in New England, Massachusetts and Rhode Island. And, you know, like some of it's really interesting the way they talk about it. They want to, Americanization of citizens of Portuguese descent. Well, that makes sense. However, some of them are really interesting, where they start to say, we want to support both Americanization, but also want to support dedication to Portuguese culture. And what was happening, and again, this is where it gets very complicated. These are not consistent categories throughout the century. And you have, you know, Cape Verdean clubs, for example. There's one Cape Verdean club that gets founded as a political club in the 30s, 1930s, trying to support political candidates. And then also makes an argument or charters an organization that's dedicated to preserving Portuguese cultural heritage. And the dichotomy that takes place in the 1960s of black and white Portuguese is not the same as was taking place in during the earlier part of the 20th century. You have many Portuguese during this period trying to make arguments over whiteness. And it's something that actually is a consistent part of the story, is that arguments over whiteness become embedded in identity discourses of Portuguese as a response to this their labor marginalization and the existing categories that found them as non-white. And you start to have some really interesting things taking place. First of all, Americanization of names. This is a very old phenomenon that takes place in the 19th century. The great myth is that customs agents were changing people's names when they arrived in the US. This is not true. If anyone was changing them, it would have been the ship's agents that are actually responsible for writing down names. But in most cases, it seems that the immigrants themselves were the ones responsible for changing their own names. And they did so as a result of a hyper-awareness, obviously, of how they were fitting into these discourses of power and how they were being, they as working labor migrants were, you know, mobile labor migrants were fitting into these discourses. By the 1950s, you start to have a lot of very overt attempts on the part of Portuguese to define themselves as white. And this is one example taken from a rewriting of a bylaws for one of the oldest associations in Rhode Island, a founded associations in Newport, Rhode Island, that defines membership as only people of the white race. And you start to see a dichotomy take place in other places as well, where a lot of the 1950s and 60s discourses, anti-black discourses, start to get picked up on by a lot of the Portuguese and earlier. And these discourses start to become very overt efforts to define the Portuguese as white. By the way, something that would have been happening for earlier in the century as well. But you have, in 1971, there's perhaps no one in the 20th century, and it's an interesting capstone as well to some of the sociology writers from earlier in the century, is you have Luciano da Silva and Dighton Rock. Now, the myth of Dighton Rock, or the court real discovery of Dighton Rock, is something that gets talked about quite a bit in the US. It gets talked about by politicians, it gets talked about in Portugal also, but there's no, even at the time and today, there's no serious scholar or serious historian in Portugal that accepts these theories of Dighton Rock. Luciano da Silva was not the first one to come up with it. This was actually come up with it by a former Brown University professor, I should mention, in the 19-teens and 1920s by the name of Delabar. And then some other writers over the century pick up on it. The Portuguese consul, and again, I would refer you at this point to an incredible book by Hunter called The Place of the Stone, which has a phenomenal historical reconstruction of Dighton Rock and sort of the Portuguese in it, as well as by, and he seems to rely on this, on most of his research about the Portuguese on, once again, on Gilberto Fernandes, who wrote his dissertation on this and some other articles, which I would also encourage everyone to read. They're great, they're really great articles. Luciano da Silva, however, is the one that's most responsible for trying to bring these ideas into Portuguese communities. And he writes, a book that effectively creates a lusotropicalist argument about Portuguese in the Americas. First of all, he sees the Portuguese as Court Real disappears right in the early 16th century. Luciano da Silva tries to reconstruct that. In fact, they actually were not, that Court Real didn't in fact disappear. He actually settled in New England where he carved his name on Dighton Rock. And I probably at this point should have a picture of Dighton Rock. I don't, but you're all at home. Google it, look up Dighton Rock. You'll see plenty of pictures. You know, you can see that that the whole concept of Dighton Rock is, you know, it's just a palimpsest of etchings that clearly had, that you know, most serious archaeologists and scholars would point had indigenous origins. However, these indigenous origins, as Hunter argues, were erased over time. One of the people erasing them and supplanting those indigenous origins with a Portuguese origin myth in America was Luciano da Silva. And I don't know, I hope you've been reading some of this on the sides, but you can see like the Lusotropicus argument, the picture that he puts in his book that was published in 1971 called Portuguese Pilgrims in Dighton Rock. You know, it's a picture of a Portuguese pulling up and, you know, his caption that they're sort of pulling up and civilizing, you know, these darker people. And so this was a neat trick that Luciano da Silva played. The goal was to try and by saying that Portuguese really had settled New England first, and that in fact, the reason that the natives here, the Wampanoags in New England, were friendlier and towards the Europeans when they arrived was because they were more Portuguese and they were whiter and more civilized. This is the argument. You know, of course, nonsensical, but as a scientific argument, but if understood as Luciano da Silva making an argument about Portuguese whiteness as part of a placemaking strategy, then, you know, this book makes sense. It's the only way that this book, you know, it doesn't make sense as science. It makes sense as a historical document about placemaking. And, you know, and you can see sort of this sort of pseudoscientific or reliance of reliance on genetic data to create these kind of pseudoscientific arguments about race and blood quantum and all these kinds of things. What's interesting is that this book gets published in 1971, which is the same year that Columbus Day is considered a federal holiday in the US. And, you know, these kinds of federal holidays, Italian, you know, if you look through the Dillingham Commission reports, they're written about in similar ways as the Portuguese. Other groups also that went through this process of what Roediger, Allen, Ignatov also talks about this, you know, goes through a process of becoming white, you know, over the course of the 20th century. And you know, no one really looks at Italians as being non-white at this point. Again, in the flow, or Irish as being non-white, they're groups that have kind of that have excuse me, you know, have transformed these identities. The Portuguese case is a little trickier, though. And you know, this argument by Luciano da Silva was one. He tried to get this turned into a federal holiday. It also plays into a whole bunch of other issues about, you know, the pilgrims and what that meant. But effectively, Luciano da Silva was arguing the Portuguese were even here before the English, were even in the US before the English. And this, you know, again, this Lusotropicalist argument. He was able to sort of try and shift a group that had been considered non-white, and with these arguments, make an argument of Portuguese whiteness. I'm gonna actually come back to this in a second. And I just want to say that some of these discourses are actually still taking place in the US. And at this point, I would refer you to the paper that I just wrote to go into this in greater depth. I have about 5 more minutes before I can take some questions. I would, for the post-1960s, I would refer to you the paper. I'll put it into the chat once we're done. You know, but if you look at this was an award that was given to a calendar. You know, that really could have been Luciano da Silva's description of Court Real arriving in New England. You know, you're seeing this from the deck of a ship. This won an award for a calendar, a student art calendar. And you know, you see these kind of nondescript, dark loincloth clad figures. Portuguese exploration ship, you know, discovers a tribe. This kind of how definitions or the way that Portuguese create this notion of whiteness, how these arguments about Portuguese whiteness is something that's still taking place. I'll give you 2 more examples. One was also this effort to create census categories for the Portuguese as well. You know, this was how people should fill out the census. This was a push that took place in the last US census by a lot of people in Portuguese. And this was the sort of part of their materials that were getting people to fill it out. And if you look at how they define all this, like they put these all in these sort of categories, these 20th century categories, white, you know, you mark white and Portuguese, mark white. And if you're mixed, and that, what is your other mix? Your other mix, of course, is Portuguese, Italian, and Irish, which are all, of course, these other groups that 20th century whiteness. Down here, what is a person's race? Portuguese, white, and Cape Verdean, black. And then you also have, you know, Portuguese, Native Hawaiian, and other Pacific Islander, some of the other identities that can take place. What's interesting in all this, you know, they didn't have different boxes checked of persons' races of Portuguese. No, it's you're Portuguese and you're white, you're Cape Verdean and you're black. I mean, you know, for the people filling these out, they could obviously fill out whatever they wanted, but the way that this literature gets put up, you know, clearly reflects some of these discourses about Portuguese whiteness. And then this is one of my favorites, which is codification for in Massachusetts for groups that start chartered nonprofit associations. So in order to start a nonprofit chartered association in the state of Massachusetts, one either has to be have to have 50% of the board be women or 50% of the board being Portuguese. But what they do here is really interesting. They call it must be members of a minority group or of Portuguese descent. So on the one hand, they're clearly saying that the Portuguese are a minority group, because if you have to have 51% of the people on the board being Portuguese, the reason for that is that they want to encourage these in Massachusetts historically underrepresented groups. However, by pulling them out of being a minority group, they're making a very schizophrenic argument here also about Portuguese identity, which is that that they want Portuguese to be a minority but without losing status as white. So, just to wrap up a couple minutes, sort of summary here of some of the things that I've talked about. A lot of this gets talked about and framed as being about assimilation. In the 1920s, immigration restrictions were passed, less Portuguese migrants claimed. Over the generations, they assimilated, they stopped speaking Portuguese, they stopped practicing culture, Portuguese cultural practices, and they assimilated. And this word assimilation, unfortunately, is often used in literature, including by a lot of people who study 20th century Portuguese history, as a conclusion rather than a contention. And what I mean by that is assimilation didn't just happen. It happened because people made a conscious choice to participate in some of these discourses of white, of whitening or becoming white. And this is not only Portuguese from the continent, it's not only Portuguese from the Azores, Cape Verdeans also participated in these assimilability discourses as well. I think it's really important to sort of stop thinking of these, also the story about the 20th century, I think, is effectively wrong. Recent research that I've done looking at the activities of associations actually points out that there was far more activity, although they were not as public. There was a huge increase in, rather than the associations ending, there's actually a tremendous increase in associations over the 1920s to 1960s, before the new wave of migration came that supposedly reinvigorated everything. To think of this assimilation as an inevitable process, I think is wrong. We should really start thinking of how privilege gets argued for by different groups of people, and how it gets structured into everyday life, and how certain aspects of Portuguese identity continue to develop this notion of Portuguese, Portuguese whiteness. I'll stop there. I didn't really get to the transition to multicultural democracy, which I think is a really interesting part of the story, because a lot of these identities get turned on their head. In fact, if you look at this, which are effectively efforts to create an ethnic category for the Portuguese that's different from other groups, both of these efforts here, what you're really talking about is the way that the Portuguese have also been able to create a place for themselves in multicultural democracy that in which it relies on both the definitions of itself as white and non-white in order for that to take place. So I'll stop there. I'm happy to entertain any questions or clarify anything. Thank you for your patience. I know we all have Zoom fatigue. And Germany, England is playing right now. But thank you.
Sorry, Dennis. Go ahead.
This is me, Dennis. Hello?
Yes.
Yes. Just two brief questions. One, what was really the acid test between white and black and in between regarding use of facilities? In other words, white or non-white? How did that evolve exactly in the area? And secondly, what was the interplay of Estado Novo and the United States regarding receiving expelled Luso Americans and who were then transferred to Tarafal, for example, or to other places under charges of being subversives or labor union leaders or communists?
Yeah,
so I'll answer the second question first, because it's the easier. In fact, what got Augusto Pinto into trouble was that there were also discourses in the US left that were anti-Salazarist and anti-Estado Novo. And he got in the hot water for some of his anti-Estado Novo activism. There were efforts to raise money also for the leftists in Spain against Franco as well. Mm-hmm. Among these groups. And when he got back, the reason he was sent to Tarafal, as I understand it, from what I've read, was because of his anti-Salazar activity. And in fact, Yula Menge decides not to go to Portugal as a result of this when she gets deported. And she decides instead to go to Poland and ends up getting she makes a conscious choice that it would be safer for her at that point to go to Poland rather than Portugal. And then the other question is actually very tricky and really gets to the heart of this conversation that we're having. So, some people talk about, Marilyn Halter actually has examples in her book, Between Race and Ethnicity, of Cape Verdeans, being placed into segregated portions of movie theaters in New England. And if you look at what was happening in different parts of the country, also there were different things taking place, right? So, in North Carolina, Portuguese weren't allowed to go to white schools. Some more recent research has been brought up on this. But effectively, they weren't allowed to go to white schools. If you look at in the 1910s in the US, on Cape Cod, you have some of these debates about segregation as well. I think that what happens is that different people were attempting to negotiate their own identities. They were trying to negotiate whiteness, basically. And that worked. If you were being considered non-white, then you could make an argument about being Portuguese being European, that helped you. In 1952, up until 1952, you wouldn't become a citizen if you were not considered from a European country. So as an immigrant, if you're coming from Africa. So, it was to people's advantage. And I think that they were conscious decisions that people made to exclude others. The way that that workspaces were segregated, the way that some Portuguese also rose into sort of intermediate positions where they were foremen over other non-Portuguese. This also happens quite frequently. So there's lots of little micro, if you're looking for a sign on a water fountain, I don't think you're going to find one with the Portuguese. What you're going to find are lots of little micro decisions by different people with different amounts of power that are contributing to these discourses and the codification of Portuguese as white or non-white.
Thank you. More questions? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
More questions? I'm asking if there are more questions or more. No? I want to say something. It's a very, very interesting view. And I was just going to ask you whether this was not class bound, that is particularly a phenomenon of the labor class. Because when we, I'm more connected with culture and literature. When I, for instance, read autobiographies by authors that were also migrants, I don't get this picture of exclusion that, in a sense, your talk gives us. Well, I'm thinking of Josephine Bickworth, who lived in the early 20th century, or of Laurinda C. Andrade, who wrote The Open Door. If we compare their work with the work of other autobiographers from Italy, from Italian descent, and so on, we don't get that sense of exclusion that you are pointing. On the other hand, I was immediately thinking of problems, of the problem of the Sacco-Vanzetti trial, and things that are more class-bound, and also have more to see with the age, with the historical age. So this is just a comment. I found it very interesting. I had no notion whatsoever.
Yeah, I mean, I think that you bring up also people like some of the writing that was taking place in Provincetown, for example, with the Bohemian writers. Dos Passos is another one I would put in that. But these are people that were largely removed from the Linda Almeida is a different example. But I think that she also writes a lot later, if I'm not mistaken. I think she publishes in the 50s or thereabouts, right?
60,
so it's
the Open Door 62. But
yeah, exactly. So some of the more earlier the earlier writers might have a different take than some of the later writers. But I think that Lorinda Almeida is a perfect example of what I'm talking about, of creating, crafting a narrative that actually helps the Portuguese to gain racial mobility and social mobility as part of a similar process. Her activities in that way of some of these writers, fits into that. But we're talking about the vast majority of people that weren't writing. They were working class laborers confronting these issues, in a way that people from upper classes were not.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
More questions? No more questions? Oh, yes. Sonia Pacheco. Sonia Pacheco.
Sim, deixa-me só pôr a mão para baixo. Miguel, this was great. So full disclosure, Miguel and I have worked closely on a number of projects, and I'm actually the archivist for the Freidamente Portuguese American Archives at UMass Dartmouth. So I both have a question, but also a comment for Dennis, if I may. I know you, Miguel, you talked a little bit about the Hawaii sort of identification. And the key to know about Hawaii is that the Portuguese were identified as being white enough to be managers, specifically middle managers, but not too white that there was a concern that they would attempt to marry the daughters of the plantation owners or own the plantations themselves. And this is explicit in the document that foregrounds the official signing of contract labor between the Kingdom of Hawaii and the Azorean Islands. So this was already happening, as early as the contract was signed, which was sometime in the early 1880s. So Dennis, that that speaks to sort of this nebulous, you know, white, but not too white, that Miguel has sort of been talking about during the whole entire presentation. My question to you, Miguel, is do you think on the, from the side of the Cape Verdeans, who were not so much today, but during this period you're speaking to, were consistently put forward as being Portuguese or as being compared to the Portuguese, do you get a sense that Cape Verdeans were also as cautious of not being identified as their own self-identity, I guess, or their own racial identity? I've got many questions and concerns with Portuguese ethnicity being a category on the census for, I'm not an ethnographer, I am not a sociologist, but as a historian, it scares the bejesus out of me because it's so inappropriate, but that's a separate conversation. But just based upon your own research, Miguel, do you see that happening in the records? Because it's one thing when we talk to people, but do the records?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, so thank you for this comment, Sonia, also, and for also the stuff you're talking about it, about Hawaii, is because you guys have all these great records from Hawaii, if I'm not mistaken. So this is something that you all should go to Fredemensch archives and check out if that stuff's online.
The first 5,000 are.
Yeah, so phenomenal. I'll use a very specific example, which is from Falmouth, and that is in the 1930s. You have one of the very first Cape Verdean clubs being founded in all of all of New England, and it's founded as a political club. Effectively, gets founded as a way to support all Portuguese candidates. One of their first acts is to, you know, they have candidates' nights for all candidates. And also start to promote different kinds of activities, but specifically as a Cape Verdean group, as a Cape Verdean club, even though their purposes were ostensibly, if you read their charter, to help promote Portuguese culture and Portuguese literature. I think that in fact they were quite aware of it in some ways. You also have some shifts that take place in this post-World War II period. When people start coming back from World War II, you also have a number of people that start to have very different senses of what it meant to be Black and white in the U.S. They were exposed to people from other parts of the country, I think, that had some different ideas about how it all fit together. And this, you know, ends up affecting or reinforcing some of those differences back in New England. But to sort of answer your question, I would say the documentary evidence that I found supports a cautiousness on the part of a lot of Cape Verdeans on how they were defined, and an effort to become or to define their identities, even though when they were defining their identities as separately Cape Verdean, to be also cognizant of the fact that they were defining their identities as separately Cape Verdean, but oh yes, by the way, also Portuguese. And then that actually has a whole post-1960s, post-colonial war, post-Portuguese or Cape Verdean independence, sort of global civil rights movement polemic that really is about how Cape Verdean identity, how Blackness and Cape Verdean Cape Verdean identity fits into U.S. discourse, civil rights movement discourses. But I think that that's, again, a later phenomenon. And by in the 30s, 40s, I don't believe that this was happening.
Thanks.
Teresa?
Yeah. I had the sound out. Okay. There are some more questions, some more comments to a very exciting presentation.
We'll have to stop now.
If anybody has any questions,
I'm happy to
send me an email or whatever, and I'm happy to talk to you further about this. I'd love to also hear if anybody has other research that you've done that contradicts anything I said or deepens it. I would also love to hear that too, if you want to send that to me. I'm fascinated by this period and the subject. So I look forward to that. And please look in the chat for that article if you haven't. And I would encourage you to look at the whole book, which actually talks about a lot of these things. The book was put out by Tagus Press, UMass Dartmouth, and Ocean Crossings, edited by Andre Nova. And it's all people from our projects, from Color of Labor projects. And there's some really fantastic writing there, also about Hawaii, as well as about ocean mobilities and Portuguese on ships. So thank you so much to Fulbright, to Professora Teresa, Professora Laura, and thank you all for taking the time to hear the talk today.
I think we should applaud.
Thank you. Very good.
Thank you very much. Well, I thank you both, and I want to tell you, can you listen to what I'm saying? Yes? I will tell you a very short story. When I visited my family in California for the first time, when I said my name, they told me, no, that's no name here in the United States. You're not Maria Laura Tancuri. You're Mary Vitanco. Otherwise, no one will listen to what you say. So this comes exactly as you were saying, to adapt to a different reality. So over there, I'm Mary Vitanco. Thank you very much to you all. Thanks for the Fulbright Commission for all the help they've given us. I thank you especially to Teresa Alves, who accepted to do this job right at the last moment and was so kind as to accept my request. Thank you all. And a special thank, obviously, to Professor Muniz for a very special talk that, in a way, charmed us all. Thank you so much. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.